All right, joining us for our first Hot Copy, we have Senator Francis Tolentino. He's the chairperson of the Senate Committee on Justice and Human Rights. Senator Tolentino, good morning to you, sir.
Morning, ma'am. Good morning to your viewers as well.
All right, now this is quite tragic. The severe maltreatment of house helper Elvie Vergara. This has been brought to light because it's circulated online. But frankly speaking, she is probably one of many house helpers in the country who are maltreated, don't get their benefits, whose salaries are paid, not paid. In other words, their lives are under the control, essentially, of their employers. What gaps are you seeing, Senator Tolentino, when it comes to the law?
The law, the Kasambahay law is good, but I think it has to be amended. And the fine, even the fine is just mere 10,000 pesos for violations being made by the employer. So I would look at strengthening the law further and making it not just within the turf of the Department of Labor and Employment, but to include perhaps the DILG, because barangay officials, barangay captains should have their own databases. Mm-mm. They should be registered within the barangay's jurisdiction, as well as perhaps, if we really made focus before on our OFWs, working abroad, domestic helpers, perhaps there should be a local version of this, mm-hmm. a local bureau or agency in charge of domestic helpers, mm-hmm. Not just for purposes of hotlines, but for purposes of really educating not just the domestic workers themselves, but the employers on their responsibilities. Mm-hmm.
Okay, this is a very good point. Okay, now Elvira's case is quite severe. That's a given. In fact, criminal charges should be filed against the employer. But it's also, I wanted to ask you, Senator, it's the relationship of house helpers with their employers in the Philippines. In places like Hong Kong, Singapore, it's more professional in the sense that there's a specific rate. Correct. There are working hours. It's quite strict. Some of them stay out and they come in. But in the Philippines, kasi, let's be honest, it depends on the employer. Pag mayaman ang employer mo, swerte ka. Pag mahirap, nakikisama ka. Parang pamilya na yun. Kumbaga, even the salaries, it's not standardized in the Philippines.
It is, ma'am. The Kasambahay law provides for that. But the problem is, when implementation comes, it's not really being followed strictly to the letter. So we have provisions of the law providing for 5,000 different rates for different regions, the working hours, the day of requirements, etc. But again, nobody's monitoring this strictly. Uh-oh. So my suggestion is that there should be a separate office. Mm-mm. Within the Department of Labor and Employment. Mm-mm. To do all of this.
That would work. And another thing, no, while we're talking about it, because let's move it further. Benefits, for example. I know so many employers that essentially they don't pay the SSS, the PhilHealth. Yes. Or ano pa ba, pag-ibig. Because I know under the law that there's a sharing scheme.
Yes.
You have some employers that cover everything. In our household, we cover everything. Kasi the logic is maliit na nga, kakaltasan mo pa. So it's a whole different science. But then you have employers that don't cover anything at all.
Yes.
So what happens? Where do these... Kasi ang problema, ang Kasambahay, they don't know where to go.
Yes.
Right? That's one thing. Where do they report?
So that's why it should be, LD was correct. She went to the barangay chairman, but unfortunately, she was turned down and returned to the employer. So the law is very specific on this. The problem is that the monitoring system is not in place. There used to be a joint memorandum circular circa 2015 that consolidated the efforts of the SWD, DILG, Department of Labor and Employment, and the local government officials. But apparently this was sidelined from what I gathered during that hearing. So it has to be part of the training kits of barangay officials when they're after their election. So Ang dami pa hong gagawin. Remember, si Manang LB never received a single centavo since he started working 2017.
That's ito kay Manang LV, it's almost outright slavery. It's the story in a way of the house helper. Do you remember in the United States? It was quite similar. A documentary was made. She was never paid at all. And also she turned blind through the years.
Yeah, but this one, she was blinded because of the force, the pain, the harm inflicted upon her. So
ang tanong ko pag ganun, she reported, went to the barangay official. The barangay official turned her down, returned her to the employer. Isn't the barangay official somehow accountable?
Yes.
I'm not speaking in the process of law.
Yes, I think that barangay chairman is one of the respondents in the case. A hearing, preliminary investigation was conducted yesterday sa Batangas Provincial Fiscal's Office. But unfortunately, the Ruiz family also did not attend for, I don't know, health reasons or what. And even the barangay captain, although during that hearing, he promised to attend the fiscal's investigation. So the first hearing was conducted yesterday. So we're looking forward to their attendance during the next hearing.
Okay. And do you think, Senator Francis, because we do have good laws, you said it, we have the laws, but is it also a matter of culture? Filipinos from different stratas, income stratas, it's not inherent or ingrained for us to fight for our own rights and to fight for those who are smaller than us, so to speak, right? Kasi in other countries, you fight for those in need. Yung mas maliit sa'yo, ipaglalaban mo. Eto, it's two things, fighting for your own rights and fighting for those who have no voice or who are perceived to have no rights.
You might be correct. It might be culturally ingrained, but the lack of aggressiveness on the part of those handicapped should be strengthened by our laws.
Yeah.
The laws should provide the gaps, the cultural inefficiency that you just mentioned a while ago. So the law should fill in the gaps as well as strengthen those aggrieved.
Yeah, oo. Parang sinabi nga yun, I believe it was Makapagal or Magsaysay.
Magsaysay.
Who said
those
it, right?
In life,
yes.
They have more in law.
Yeah, so they have more in the law, but then the problem is the law is not acted upon their favor. Parang that's the problem in the country. Because what else will you amend, Senator Tolentino? What will you amend if the Kasambahay law?
I would suggest that if this is not too much, since I sit in the Judicial Bar Council, that there should likewise be a special court to handle cases involving domestic helpers. The Supreme Court can perhaps assign in one region a regional trial court to handle cases involving this. So it will draw more inspiration, perhaps awareness, greater awareness on the part of the domestic helpers, as well as inform the employers that indeed the law can reach them wherever they are.
Okay, so let's move on from another topic, because the test in this particular case is if the Ruiz family, despite them not attending the hearings, if at some point they will be convicted and they will face the weight of the law. That would be one strong example, right?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Let's move on to another issue. Another hearing right now, and it's all over the newspapers. It's almost like a Hollywood movie, or correct. It's incredulous is the word. Is you believe that officers of the National Bilibid Prisons might be behind the escape of Michael Cataroja. Now, for those who are watching, Michael Cataroja is a maximum security inmate of NBP. Ang nangyari, nawala po siya. People thought he was dead, and it turned out he escaped and he was caught again. And he claims to have escaped either clinging under the garbage truck of the National Beloved Prisons or walking out with visitors. What makes you say that you think the officers helped him? Why would they help him?
I think some because he cannot escape. I do believe that it's really baffling for him to be able to just get off the premises of the national penitentiary, considering the presence of CCTVs, the presence of armed guards, several gates that you have to.
If you cling under the truck, I mean, I know tama ka, Senator, it's so Hollywood. But di ba pinakita niya sa inyo?
Yes, yes.
So napaisip ako, kung nakasabit siya talaga under the garbage truck, I'm sure naman we don't have dogs, right? I've been to Bilibid, wala namang aso yon.
They have some canine, yes.
Okay.
And they have mirrors that can be used.
But did they use it? Yun ang tanong.
Yes, I think the bottom line here, Karen, is how can a person tightly guarded in a national a maximum security compound be able to accomplish all of this with all the security and protective measures in place? So that's the reason why I said perhaps he might be in cahoots with some guards or officials there, because you cannot really do that. Nung pinasakay namin siya sa ilalim, after 5 minutes, nainita na siya.
Ah, ganun ba?
Yes. So makit yung likod niya.
Tama kasi yung makina umaanda.
Yes. And then, sabi niya, it took him almost 3 hours to reach C6. So, tinanong ko, how can you identify whether that road is C6 or S-legs, because they're all the same. They're all the same pavements.
Good
so
point.
So it's really mind-boggling.
So you don't believe, honestly speaking, you don't believe that he clung on to the garbage truck?
From what I've seen, but I will still wait for the results of the Board of Inquiry investigation being conducted by General Katapang. So I will still wait for the results. They promised me by next week it will be out. So
okay.
The circumstances, the details, etc., will be inputted there.
Okay. Could it be, Senator, I'm just curious, that he clung on to the garbage truck under, when it got off the gate, at some point he rolled out of the truck, right? He rolled out. So kumbaga, he didn't have to last 3 hours clinging under the truck.
He would
Which
be seen because
makes
he would...
sense that in 5 minutes, mainit na, hindi na niya kaya, bibitaw na siya. But pwede siya masagasaan.
He would be seen because he is still wearing that orange uniform.
Oo nga.
And that compound is so big that it would take you minutes to reach the open highway leading either to Mamplasan or the SLEX. But I think there are still some things behind this story, because
uh-oh,
if you got hold of my exchanges during that hearing, Mr. Cataroja admitted that they've been planning this for such a long time.
Okay.
With some of his friends and with some of the prisoners there, PDLs, and some were able to go out, some were not able to return, some died.
Yeah.
So kung narinig nyo yun, inamin niya na nag-uusap sila, sinabi niya mahiwaga daw dun sa loob, nag-uusap sila, may nakalabas, may nakabalik, may namatay.
Oo. Okay, but then, ang Bilibid, alam naman natin, when I speak with lawmakers, it's a perennial problem. Through the years, either it's drugs, it's the inequality inside of Bilibid, it's the lack of budget, now it's an escaped inmate from maximum, corruption within the force inside Bilibid. Kumbaga, Senator, hindi na to bago.
Yes.
What needs to be done? Hindi reformative ang ating prison system.
Yes, so I subscribe to the proposals that perhaps the maximum security compound should be transferred elsewhere.
Okay.
The entire Bilibid prison should just house 9,000 prisoners. And they're all almost 30,000 right now.
Mm-mm.
So if we can transfer the maximum outside Iwahig or And then transfer perhaps the medium security compound to the Sablayan area in Mindoro. It will probably make it more humane inside what is left over. And then again, you will see perhaps a better management because few people being overseen and managed, mas madali na siguro. And plus, we need more capital investments for the, some are suggesting perhaps even the minimum security can be privatized. Just but like what other countries.
They? And they do that in some other countries.
Yes. So marami pa hong gagawin doon, ma'am. And I think prison reforms probably might not just be reflective of symptoms of our judicial justice system, but society at large. So again, you mentioned the word reformative. Marami pa hong gagawin. It's happening not just in the Philippines but in other countries as well. So we really have to focus on this.
Okay.
If you want them to be back in the mainstream after serving their term.
Okay. Now, very quickly, I'm going to go off topic now. I know that you are, this is already, it's not about your Committee on Justice and Human Rights, but just two issues very quickly right now. Secretary Diokno, and this is our discussion after, is suggesting that the Free College Act should be either scrapped or revamped. Now, this has been quite controversial. We do know that UP, for example, everybody now in UP is free. When I went to UP, it was subsidized. With UP, they would look at the background of your family. So the issue now is whether rich or poor you pass UP, is you are free, right? Whether taga Forbes Park ka or taga Tondo ka, indigent ka, basta libre ka sa UP. And the issue now is the finance team is saying this isn't sustainable. I'll be discussing that later on with Congressman Rufus Rodriguez in full. But offhand, what are your thoughts?
There's a constitutional provision that free access to education should always be maintained. I am for free access to education. I am for greater opportunities for our youth. Hindi po siguro dapat maging dahilan yung kakulangan sa salapi ng pamahalang nasyonal na hindi sila mapagbigyan ng pagkakataong mag-aral. So that is a basic human right, even tertiary education. We need to provide our youth with the necessary basic tertiary education.
Mm-mm. Okay. All right. So you believe that it shouldn't be scrapped?
Yes.
Okay. On that note, I want to thank you for joining me today, Senator
you,
Francis Tolentino.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I'll see you again soon.